So I just want to, I've said my piece, so I'm just going to turn this over to Paul Constantino from St. Michael's College. He's a professor there of anthropology, and as I said before, an invaluable member of this team to make this happen. So he'll come up and introduce our speaker.
Thank you very much. It is my sincere pleasure to introduce someone who is not only one of the foremost experts in paleoanthropology or human evolution, but who I also consider a friend, although he may try to deny that latter part. Rick Potts is the director of the Smithsonian's Human Origins Program and the Peter Buck Chair of Human Origins at the Smithsonian. He has got his degree from Harvard University, a small mid-level school you might have heard of, in biological anthropology. Shortly after that, went to teach at another middle-level school called Yale University, where he was also a curator at the Peabody Museum. And he took his curatorial skills then to the Smithsonian. To be precise, he did that in 1985, and he's been at the Smithsonian ever since, and they're very lucky to have him. In addition to curating this traveling exhibit, as well as the permanent exhibit at the National Museum of Natural History in D.C., Rick is also a very dedicated researcher, and he spent the last many years studying human evolution and how it maps on to changing environments. He has two primary sites, one in East Africa, one in China, and both have profoundly influenced how we understand human evolution. The site in China is home to some of the oldest stone tools from that region at between 1.6 and 1.7 million years old. And the site in East Africa, Ologosili, is one of the only early human sites to have a long drill core obtained from that site, which means that Rick and his team will be able to map human adaptation onto about 500,000 years of changing climates. So it's really exciting stuff. I got to know Rick personally when I was a graduate student at George Washington University in DC. Our program was affiliated with the Smithsonian, so I got to take seminars with Rick. I got to hear him speak on many different occasions. And again, he may not admit this, but he even served a short stint on my graduate committee. And I am very fortunate to say that I also was able to help out at several of his famous Halloween haunted houses that he does at his own residence. And I'm talking kids lined up down the block and news crews outside interviewing kids as they come in. So I can tell you from personal experience that not only is he an intelligent, creative, and dedicated researcher, but he is also extremely generous, fun, and very kind person to be around. And I'm really excited to have him here in Burlington. So please help me welcome Dr. Rick Potts.
I'm amazed how well Paul has studied over the years. Thank you very much, Paul, for the kind words. And thanks to the leadership of this library and the people of Burlington. It's fantastic to be here with you to introduce officially open the exhibit exploring human origins. What does it mean to be human? As was explained earlier, it was part of this exhibit is and our visit here is part of a 19 venue tour. I want to say venues because it's not just cities. It's been some pretty small towns. 2016 was an interesting year to go across the country. I'll just leave it as that, okay? And here we are, 2017, and it's spectacular to be here. In 2010. Is when we, March 2010, is when we opened up the permanent Hall of Human Origins at the Smithsonian's National Museum of Natural History. It took a long time to get that project going, and it took about 5 years of raising some funds and developing the ideas for the exhibit, working with a fantastic and very creative exhibits team and education team and writers, we were totally exhausted in March 2010 when it opened. But it only took a few months to think, okay, let's do more. There have now been about 30 million people or visits to the Hall of Human Origins at the Smithsonian. And to us, it's not enough. Bringing it out on the road, bringing it to you, bringing it where we've been across the country has been really, really important to us, a fantastic experience. And I hope you enjoy it. We really do live in an astonishing slice of history where discoveries have changed and have challenged our view of ourselves. If you look at mapping of the human genome, to be able to look at the genetic code of human beings and what we pass on biologically to future generations, it's pretty astonishing. Space exploration, the ability to see our planet as a whole, and with satellite technology to be able to explore the impacts of human beings, the very serious impacts of people on the planet. And also discoveries in human origins, which allow us to peer back into our deep past, the past that we all share, every human being on the planet, and to be able to perhaps understand through what has come before who we are today, and maybe a little bit of thought about where we're going in the future. So those are pretty astonishing things. And so it's a terrific pleasure, and we realize a responsibility to be here and with you in Burlington to open the exhibit Exploring Human Origins. You'll notice that the theme of the exhibit is not a statement, it's a question. A question, what does it mean to be human? And we realize that that is a very large question. It is a question that is informed by the science. Indeed, the exhibit is a science exhibit. It's an exhibit that focuses in on the fossil discoveries and archaeological remains, and even has a little bit about the genomic studies that help combine to inform the scientific exploration of human origins. But at the same time, the theme is this much broader question, a question that goes beyond the science. What does it mean to be human? And so I'd like to actually begin this evening by asking your thoughts. We'll just take a few examples. So put on your thinking caps, and if you could be concise, that would be cool. And we'll begin in a few minutes. Let me just first say that that is a question that is informed by the many different ways by which we try to understand our humanity and our place in the world. It's informed by religious reflection, by philosophy, by the books that we read. I have to say that, we're in a library. Literature, the arts in general, the ethics and values that we learn as we're growing up. It's a question that is informed by also our everyday experiences. And we can begin to gain an understanding of who we are, and we can reflect on ourselves as human beings through those everyday experiences. It is at the same time a subject, human evolution, that is complex, it is challenging, and for some people it is troubling. And it's important to acknowledge that. Don't know if it's troubling for people in this audience, but it has been troubling for people in other places in the country where we've been. And every place is diverse in the perspectives that people bring to this subject. And so the goal of the exhibit and the goal of our program surrounding it is to nurture with your help and the help of the community, an open and civil conversation about this complex and profound subject. And so with those thoughts in mind, I would like to open the floor. Hey, how about that in Vermont, a town hall? Isn't that great? So I'd just like to take a few answers. And so just, you know, raise your hand. There is no right or wrong answer to that question, believe me. But I'd like to hear some of your perspectives and thoughts. And by the way, let me just say that with regard to a conversation, tomorrow evening, 6 o'clock, is that when it is, that we have this community conversation. And it really is meant to be a conversation. It's not a lecture. It's not a talk. And in addition to myself, there are my colleagues from the Smithsonian, Dr. Brianna Pobiner, who's just led an educator's workshop today, along with Connie Bertka and Jim Miller. And Connie and Jim will lead the conversation to tomorrow, but we'll all be there. And Connie and Jim are the co-chairs of a group of people who have assisted us at the Smithsonian called the Broader Social Impacts Committee. Yeah, we're from Washington, D.C., so BSIC is what it's called. That was not meant to be so much emphasis on the BS, no. Broader social is a very, very important thing. If science is going to mean anything to society, we need to think about the broader ramifications for society. And so there are a very important group of about 15 people representing different faith perspectives, philosophical perspectives, come with different academic backgrounds with regard to the science, religion, philosophy, ethics, and education conversation that can go on in America. And they've been terrific. And so you'll be hearing more from them tomorrow. And in addition, we also have those sticky notes out there. I love the answers out there. In the introductory part of the exhibit, there's a place where you can have these post-it notes, and you can write an answer. And we have received everything from in various stops around the country on those stickers, from one word to what appear to be PhD theses written on them. It's amazing how small people can write. In any case, we're interested in whatever you'd like to say to us and to yourselves, to one another, about this question, what does it mean to be human? So with that in mind, who would like to start? Come on. Yeah, don't be shy, step right up. Yes, please, sir.
I would say to be human is to be an animal with sustainable cultures.
An animal with sustainable cultures, indeed. Yeah, one of the sort of principal areas of human origin studies is to study the materials that people leave behind, and we'll be looking at some of that later on in the talk, and that is suggestive that sustaining culture actually goes far back in time. So yeah, it's a good one. Yeah, another, yes, please, sir.
Focused discipline, so like mathematics, religion, right?
Right, focused discipline, and we can divide that world of discipline up into many different sort of boxes, but to be able to have a way of focusing in, which takes a lot of brain power, but also builds upon the foci and the focus of many people, forming a field of study. Thank you. Yep. Another thought? Yes, please.
I've heard other lecturers mention how separating us from the other primates on a large scale, we are the most cooperative.
Right. Cooperation and the scale of cooperation. Of course, many organisms, one could even say that any multicellular organism has cells that cooperate, but in terms of social, whereby we depend upon one another, the scale of cooperation and, let's say, also the scale of conflict can also be, which also is a form of cooperation, I suppose, to get the scales that human beings do today. That's a great one. Yeah. Other thoughts? Yes, please, ma'am.
I think one of the things that's special about humans is our ability to see things from other perspectives.
To imagine another person's perspective, to think about it, contemplate it, and see it. It's something that some biologists and behavior people call having a theory of mind. In other words, being able to project yourself into the mind of someone else. And of course, one thing that may be on some of your top of the list about our humanity is language. And language is a form of really, what we're doing now is really a form of, well, I bet you can't predict what I'm going to say next necessarily, but of sort of exchanging ideas mind to mind. So it's, yeah, pretty cool, amazing. Yes, please.
The use of tools, we know that other animals use tools, but have advanced the use of tools and developed more and more.
Right, so the development of advanced tools, and I'll also be referring to that a little bit later on in the talk toward the end. But yeah, the ability not just to use tools and to make tools like other animals, some other animals can, but also to build upon steps of one tool and then addition to another, the accumulation of culture, if you will, of cultural ideas and ability to produce things. Yeah, quite a unique thing. Yes, please, ma'am.
The ability to look beyond, way in the future.
Yeah.
What is it possible to do today?
Does
that happen in other animals?
Not to the extent that it does in us, I would say. There is certainly anticipation for a variety of animals of where they might find food. They have a kind of a, some animals have a very extensive mental map of where they can find food, where squirrels have stored food, things like this. But to be able to anticipate or at least contemplate such vast reaches of time beyond our own lifetimes is really quite unique to human beings. Yeah, and sir, did you? Yeah.
In human is also the ability to share, not just through language, but also through arts and multimedia presentations, things like you have downstairs, display downstairs, but also through language in different methods, different forms. So poetry, prose, and simply photography or film.
Are you in a profession that does that kind of communication? Because that's a beautiful answer. Anyway, that's great. Yeah, to be able to share in all those variety of ways that require our capacity for symbolism, symbolic behavior, being able to put things in abstract terms and share them and to have the technologies then like film and so on, the internet, whatever, to support that. Well, yeah, I'll take one more. Yes, please, sir.
Well, I noticed on the down when folks were speaking down below, the new acquisition show, and the companion book was up there, and right there. What does it mean to be human? And immediately underneath it was the sign that said, new fiction.
Yeah. That I noticed that too, and let me just say, one of the characteristics of being human is a great, great sense of humor, and that's how I took that. Okay, a couple more. One more.
I immediately thought of Wendell Berry and his piece of Wild Things. The contrast to that is we do tax ourselves
with a forethought of.
Of grief.
Ah, yeah, that's right. Our capacity for grief, attachment. Yeah, I mean, you know, our closest living relatives are primates. We are primates, and all primates tend to be very emotional, and they can vocalize their emotions, things like that. But to have the capacity for attachment that we do, again, largely through our symbolic behavior, is really quite profound. Yes, and one more, truly one more.
I just wanted to say that I believe that many animals can create things, but we have an incredible capacity to have creative minds and across all disciplines.
Right. So our creativity really comes in your mind, and I would say many people's minds, with regard to what we do. I mean, in terms of building things, we build things more than pretty much any other creature. Many, many creatures alter their environment. Grasses create soil out of bare earth. Elephants can alter their environment to push over trees in order to get water. Nothing at quite the scale that we do, but also at the same time, we have this amazing capacity to create in our mental and social realms that is pretty much unsurpassed. This is a fantastic audience, I can tell, but I'm going to actually just call it right there. And please come tomorrow, because there will be more of this kind of discussion about the question, what does it mean to be human? And usually I'm you know, bouncing around the stage, but I've been told, well, if this is going to work, I better stay put. So if you see me kind of going like that, that's just the internal part of me wanting to bounce around the stage. Anyway, one of the things I wanted to say is that you can find a lot of information that follows up on the exhibit, and that follows actually people's answers from around the world to this question, what does it mean to be human? Many, many, many thousands of answers that you can see on our website, humanorigins.si for Smithsonian Institution.edu. So lots of stuff on the scientific stuff. You can see the objects in the exhibit in 3D. You can rotate them and take a look at them. And then the resources developed by that team that I mentioned, the broader social impacts team, and their personal statements about how they understand human origins in the context of their beliefs about the world. And we hope to get, and we will, we not just hope, we are actually doing it right now. We're getting a page for each of the libraries up on the website. So ultimately, you'll be able to see the answers that everyone contributed in your community and compare them with others if you want to. Depends how much you really want to dive into it, if you're starting to compare with other communities throughout the U.S. But if you find anything interesting in the data, tell us. That'd be great. In any case. And so what I'd like to do tonight is to share with you three vignettes, I guess. I'd call them research stories that are based in recent findings in the pursuit of human origins and human evolutionary history. And I think that they relate, many of them, to quite a number of your comments already about what does it mean to be human. I think they relate to some pretty neat and fundamental aspects of our humanity, sharing and caring, brain, babies, and parenting, and innovations, our symbolic lives, and social networking. So, but let me just first make a couple of introductory comments. This is where I have, Kenya has been where I've spent about a quarter of my adult life, and much of it on this, you know, it's interesting. The screen does not take the laser pointer. Anyway. Up on the upper left-hand corner there is a row of tents, and that much of it has been spent there. That's my home away from home in the Rift Valley of southern Kenya, in the site with a hard-to-pronounce name. It's pronounced Olorgesailie. It's a Maasai word, a place name for the famous Maasai people who live in the region. And you can see that there are layers and layers and layers of dirt, of sediment that have built up over time. When this was once a low-lying place in the Rift Valley, where there had been a lake and streams and many different environments. And because the Rift Valley is so dynamic a place, the whole area, this region, got lifted up due to earthquake activity. And so the places that were low-lying were lifted up and became erosional. It was no longer layer after layer after layer, but wind and water could come through and do the first excavating. And so we depend upon, in this realm of making discoveries and excavations, on places that are erosional. We just walk around and find things tumbling out of the fossils and stone tools, tumbling out of the hillsides, and then we go in and we do our own excavating. But nature starts it first, and that's how we know where to go and how to find things. So once you do that, you can then go and find some pretty interesting things. The slide, the image on the left is an excavation of a butchery site of an extinct form of elephant. It's about 1 million years old, almost exactly 1 million years old. I'm told by the geochronologists working on this, who put together the variety of evidence about dating, that it's 1,005,000 years old. And it's the jaw is down at the lower part of the slide, and the tail end was up at the top. The elephant was caught in a kind of a swampy area, and around the bones of the elephant were 2,300 sharp stone tools, and there were cutting marks, butchery marks on the ribs and the vertebrae. And the early people who were living out on this a grassland, a very drying environment, would have been a pretty tough time. And they found this amazing amount of food that they could exploit on the landscape. And our excavations have, we don't just dig in these sort of like treasure hunting, you know, wow, look what we found. We actually dig across entire ancient landscapes to figure out where early humans were hanging out, what places they were avoiding, and things like that. On the right side is a site that I'm currently excavating. Well, no, I'm currently with you, but I mean, but over the I started last year, and we've been finding some terrific things. A large, very very large skeleton of a fossil lion, largest that's ever been found in the fossil record, and an ecosystem of antelopes and carnivores and zebras and whatnot that we don't quite see at any time in the past or in the present. It's about 500,000 years old, we think, although the dating work is still going on because it's just a new site. So I go back to Kenya in 17 days, and we'll look to see what the what we have really found, as all the dirt has now been picked off of the fossils from last season. And it's an international endeavor. These are three of the field teams that that I've gotten together and have had the privilege of working with, local excavators, some of whom have worked with me for more than 30 years now, and some of my closest friends, and a great team of scientists and PhD students who have joined in the effort. And work in East Africa at the top and on the right side. And the lower left is work I've done in China with two of my closest colleagues there. As you can tell, northern China in November, not always the best time to excavate in northern China, kind of cold, but nonetheless. And these are teams of people who come from different cultures, different language backgrounds, have different beliefs about the world, from all these the different nations, and science is a way of communicating across those diverse life experiences and perspectives, communicating about the discoveries that we're making, and the new discoveries contributed by research teams from all around the world. Are continuing to rewrite the narrative of human origins, build up our understanding of human origins. And we have a panel in the exhibit called What's Hot in Human Origins, where you can see some of the latest things, including one thing that really captures people's imagination, the Neanderthal Genome Project. You all may have heard about the Human Genome Project, investigating and mapping our own genes, but the DNA has now been found in the fossil bones of Neanderthals. In fact, going back to about 400,000 years ago. That is a real growth industry in this field of paleoanthropology where it meets genetics. It's absolutely fascinating. And I have to say about the new discoveries that are on the panel downstairs, there's some terrific stuff on the Fletcher Free website. That will help you to investigate that more. Check out the library website, it's cool. This is an odd photograph. This is my office at the Smithsonian. The reason why, in particular, it's odd and saying this in a library is that one day when I was out of the office, a good friend of mine who's an excellent photographer snuck into my office, took all the books off the shelves, and put all of these objects on here and took the photo. And these are the objects that went into the Hall of Human Origins right before they were installed into the permanent exhibit. And so my books still have not gotten back into order, but nonetheless. But it underlines the wealth of evidence on which we depend in developing our understanding and the narrative of our evolutionary history. The fossil skulls that you see in the background in the corner are parts of skeletons of individuals who stood upright on two legs. And all of them had small canine teeth, eye teeth, in both the males and the females. And those are two of the first changes that we see in our evolutionary history. Things that help us understand, okay, this particular skull or bone of the body that can indicate that shows it's on our side of the evolutionary tree of life. Okay, standing upright, walking, and having small canine teeth in males and females. You may be familiar that in other primates that the males have long dagger-like canines. So there must have been some kind of a change in the ways that males were relating to other males or males were relating to females. That kind of aspect of the social life we don't really understand very much about those ancestors that go back and show those characteristics back to 6 million years or more. We also have the evidence of stone tools, stone artifacts, the things that starting around a little over 3 million years ago, but really, really having a tradition of making stone tools beginning a little bit more than 2.5 million years ago, starting then and moving forward. And these are the things that people made. It's the beginning of us leaving garbage on the landscape, and archaeology depends upon finding garbage, actually. And so they littered the landscape with these things that they made. They tell us about their activities. They're kind of like their business cards. I was here. So we depend upon them to understand something about not only the technology, but the behavior of those early ancestors and cousins, evolutionary cousins of ours. We also see there in the front of the table some art objects, objects that indicate you can maybe see that reddened, flattened, flat stone there. That's the one of the world's oldest artists' palettes, where pigment was ground into the surface before it was applied to a cave wall. That comes from 20,000 years ago in a cave site in France, part of the Smithsonian collections. And then a variety of other things of symbolic artifacts. We also find in the archaeological record evidence of fire hearths, as you would find at a campsite, for example, and other sorts of artifacts. And then we also have animal bones that are come from some of those archaeological sites. I mentioned instance example before of cut marks placed on, butchery marks placed on bones. And that can help us tell something about the changes in diet in these early human ancestors. And those edges of stone tools can also tell us about changes in the diet from the polishes and striations on the edges to know what those tools were used for. So just some of the things that we do and look for. Of course, all of this, all these discoveries require a sense of time, knowing and understanding a sense of time. How can we understand such vast stretches of time? Paleoanthropologists, as we're called, work with chemists and physicists and a lot of geologists who have a whole battery of techniques of about 12 or 13 at this point, different methods and tests that can, for example, compare, or rather they can measure the decay of radioactive elements from one element to another, which occurs in a clock-like way. That occurs at this site. There is a volcanic ash at the bottom of the hillside and at the top of the hillside you see right in front of you. And it ranges from 670,000 years at the bottom to about 633 at the top, and a lot of time in between, therefore. And the radioactive particles in the volcanic ashes help us understand that. There are also tests that count electrons that are captured in fossils and rocks, you know, also over time. Others that compare the magnetic particles in sediment to well-dated shifts in Earth's magnetic field. And then, as I also alluded to with the Neanderthal Genome Project, is that you can use actually genomes to begin to look at to calculate the rate of genetic changes through time and get a sense of time that way as well. So a variety of techniques. Well, change through time and the origination of a whole variety of characteristics of our humanity makes sense. It could have been that when the concept of evolution was first contemplated, that it could have been found that the Earth was stable and unchanging for long periods of time. It turns out that the last 6 million years, well, all of Earth's history has been changing, but the last 6 to 7 million years have been one of the most dramatic eras of change in Earth's history with regard to glacial times and warm times, between cold and warm, as represented by that curve that comes from measuring oxygen isotopes, which is a temperature measure from little tiny organisms, microorganisms, in cores from the deep sea, helping us understand temperature variations through time. And it's also in equatorial places like Africa, where there have been tremendous changes in rainfall, switches back and forth between wet and dry. And for those of you who are interested, I don't know if you can actually see it on here, but that last little line on the right-hand side is going up. And it's almost getting in, it's gotten into the present-day Earth's temperature, into the yellow and inching into the orange zone. And you can see it's the warmest the planet has been, certainly since the origin of our species 200,000 years ago, but even the origin of our genus, the genus Homo, as we're Homo sapiens, the origin of the root of us, going back a couple million years, more than a couple million years. So it gives one pause. And so as we go back to and study past environments, as the conditions of life changed, as there were shifts in food and water and the shelter that could be found, it makes sense that new adaptations, new appearances and ways of life were able to emerge. And they emerged due to the benefits of those novel approaches to life as conditions changed in new environments. And so when you put all of these areas of science together, the dating and the fossils, the artifacts, the environmental changes, we can see then an outline, certainly, and this is just a few of the points that we can note, an outline of changing adaptations over time, the origin of new adaptations. And so what you can see there, this is just a few from the last 1 million years, but the most rapid increase in the size of the brain relative to the size of our body has been over the last 1 million years. There were increases in brain size before that, but there were accompanied by the expansion of body size, the range of body sizes, including enlargement of the body. You have controlling fire and building shelters, which I'll talk a little bit more about, and some of these other ones I'll be talking about also later, of the emergence of our symbolic capabilities and of our cultural capabilities. And then going back even further, back to 6 million years, 6 to 2 million years, again, just a few examples, but walking upright on two legs, increases in the range of foods that were eaten, that is known from looking at scratches on teeth and the kind of scratches that food makes on your teeth. And you can see the expansion of the kinds of dents and indentations and scratches on the teeth from the food. Stone flaking, simple stone flaking that continues by 2.6 million years ago, and a number of other sorts of things, changes in, the elongation of the legs starting around 2 million years ago, allowing longer distance movement around the landscape, and some initial advances in technology, hand axe technology, by a little bit more than about 1.75 million years ago. So where does Homo sapiens fit? That's where our species has its origin, based on the fossil record known so far, about 200,000 years ago. And if you look at the DNA in our mitochondria, which are little organelles inside our cells, little bodies inside our cells, that they all have their own DNA, which rapidly changes. And if you look at the DNA of the mitochondrial from across the world, it also converges back to Africa about 200,000 years ago. So there, the fossils and the genetics seem to be coinciding on that particular point in that particular place. And so one of the implications of this, well, look at that for a moment. Now, some of the things that we think is so distinctively human as characteristic of our own species, Homo sapiens, are things that we have inherited from earlier ancestors, from earlier species. Things like the initial increases in brain size, having fire, building shelters, the beginnings of technology that could persist and develop over time. Those are things that are inheritances of our species from earlier ones. And it's through these kinds of studies that we can look at this. And so the exhibit Exploring Human Origins is very much an invitation to explore some of these milestones and others that are part and parcel of the emergence of our humanity over time, the roots of our existence on Earth. So let's get to these three stories, short stories, quickly. First one, Sharing and Caring. And a place to start on this would be our closest living biological relatives. And I'm sorry for those in the back that the bottom is probably a little small, but it shows that 99.9% genetic similarity of all people on Earth today. Very, very strong unity, genetic unity, despite all the outward diversity of our kind, that there is a very strong genetic unity to us. And you can look at this kind of chart on one of the exhibit panels downstairs. We belong to the group known as primates. Our closest living biological relatives. And just as DNA, as you're familiar with, whether it's just through CSI or something other than that, more sophisticated perhaps, that DNA is something that whereby we can explore our relationship with one another. And the same applies as you can trace it to other living creatures on Earth. And one of the foundations of this kind of work and of these sorts of evolutionary studies is that human beings are connected to all other forms of life on Earth. We're part of a great tree of genealogy that connects all living forms, and we connect to the tree of life through the primates, with the chimpanzees and bonobos being our closest living biological or genetic relative. And so primates are also very social and learn from one another. They can use tools. They don't make tools by using another tool to make a tool. That's something unique to us, but they do use tools and make tools by using their hands to make a tool. And they learn from one another, and they can even share food at the places where they can where they find the food. But for all the wonderful answers you gave to what does it mean to be human? This is actually one of my favorites. And I take it for granted all the time. And you might think, why is he showing a supermarket? Well, when we go, and this is not just us living in an urban or industrial world, but when any human being goes out and looks for food, we don't eat the food right away. I mean, I hardly ever go to the supermarket and start ripping open packages and feeding myself, you know. Instead, what I do, and what we almost all do, is we bring it to others. We take it to another place. And often with an expectation of sharing, of giving it to not only our children, and so of course many different animals can bring food to a nest to feed young, but we also feed other adults. And we even give food away to people we don't even know. And this is something that that occurs in all human societies, and so it's a bit different from what occurs and even in our closest living biological relatives. So can we tell anything about when this got started, this transporting of food and not eating things right away? And it turns out that in excavations, including ones that our team has done and at the place called Kenjera, on the shores of Lake Victoria in western Kenya, where teams have been doing research there since 1987. We have excavations of 2 million-year-old sites that show of the most basic toolkit, stone toolkit, of a hammer stone and sharp flakes, and then the core that is struck to have those sharp flakes fly off and have a pattern of scarring on the core. That's the early toolkit. We have evidence of a change to a diet that's rich in meat. We have cut marks on the bones, and we also have hammerstone percussion marks on the bone to get at that. It might seem disgusting to us, but it must have been a pleasure way back then of that fatty bone marrow, very, very nutritious, particularly in tough times. And also evidence on the edges of stone tools where there's polish that is uniquely identified of peeling underground tubers and roots, getting the dirt off of them. And so there was an expansion of the diet that included both meat and in vegetables by virtue of being able to dig underground and to get inside of a carcass and do some work. We also have evidence of carrying stones. From looking at the chemistry of the stones that the tools are made out of, we can trace where those stones came from. And they come from about 8 to 9 miles away in some cases. And so the stone was brought from distant sources. And we have the animal bones that are coming from many different kinds of habitats, not ones present right there at this archaeological site, from what we can tell from the different kinds of environmental evidence we find at this dig site. And so we have evidence that by 2 million years ago, they weren't eating food right away. They were bringing food, perhaps with the expectation of sharing. We're not absolutely sure of that, but they brought a lot of food to these sites, so we expect that that's probably what they were doing, going back 2 million years. And so this early toolkit was a real tremendous shift in early human activities. With a hammer stone, you could crush more effectively than an elephant's molar. And with a sharp stone flake, you could cut more effectively than a lion's canine tooth. And so all of the foods of the African woodlands and grasslands were opened up to those early ancestors who made even such a simple technology. And of course, this is the beginning. This is the root of our dependence upon technology. One might even see this as the start, even though it's not a hint of what was to come 2 million years later in us, but the start of altering our immediate surroundings and the building up of a way of life that ultimately became so successful that it laid the groundwork for a single species, us, that has altered the world. And so with that capacity to make stone tools, to eat food, to transport food to other places, to share it with others, we have evidence that by a little bit after 2 million years ago, we have the first spread of those early ancestors and cousins, evolutionary predecessors, out of Africa, where there had been a 4 million year record of fossils, to a place, parts of the world, where there had not been any kind of record of early humans, to Asia and to the gates of Europe. And my work over in China, in the Nihewan Basin, Yuenmo Basin, and the work of other teams in Sangiran, shows that by about 1.7 million years ago, 1,700,000, by around that time, that there is a spread of a predecessor, Homo erectus, probably, is the name of the species, that spread across there and had an amazing capacity to adjust to many different kinds of climate and biological realms, at the beginning of a hint of our own species adaptability. And the spread of Homo sapiens, of course, is much later, well after the origin of our species, after 200,000 years ago. And so this was just a hint of us as our ancestors, as explorers, as colonizers, as, what can I say, people are on the move. We move around the world. I'm not going to go there with regard to the implications of that, but in any case. And so let me just focus for a moment on one site up in the upper left-hand corner, Dimonisi. I had the wonderful opportunity to visit the site of Dimonisi, fossil site there, in the Republic of Georgia. I visited there in September and got a chance to see the fantastic fossil record there. So far published five different skulls and skeletons that go back about 1.8 million years, 1,800,000 years ago. I throw around these numbers so easily. I know they're vast ranges of time, but I understand if you're having trouble grappling with that range of time, but 1.8 million years ago, and this particular individual has fascinated paleoanthropologists. I call him the old man from Dimonisi. We have other parts of his skeleton we know is a male individual from parts of the pelvis. But what do you notice about this individual? Notice anything in particular? Yeah. Oh, no, you can't answer. Sean is our webmaster from the Smithsonian, but he lives in Vermont, so he's... what do you notice? Yeah, please. Toothless. Toothless, that's right. And any forensic scientist, in fact, any dentist, could tell you that this individual didn't have teeth for quite a number of years before passing away. Probably for anywhere, the ranges vary from some say a minimum of 3 years, others say perhaps up to 5 or even 8 years of being toothless, no teeth at all. And the bone had been resorbed because there was no action of the teeth and chewing on the jaw. And so this may be the earliest evidence, it's been proposed, that this may be the earliest evidence in the fossil record of an individual being taken care of by others. Again, a body from the other bones of the body, we know that he couldn't have moved around much at all and had no teeth. Perhaps someone was chewing food for him or, you know, cutting it up very finely. Could this be the roots of an ability to care? It's a possibility. Another example, much later in time, 65,000 years ago, in the famed Neanderthals in our fossil history. This is from a cave in northern Iraq called Shanidar. There are several Neanderthal burials inside of that cave. And this particular individual, Shanidar 1, is the name of the individual, the first fossil human that was found in the cave of a Neanderthal. Had a blow to the left side of the skull. And you can see where the fracture had healed, especially under x-rays, you can see that, but slightly flattened. And that blow to the left side of the head affected the left side of the brain, and the left side of the brain controls the right side of the body. And if you compare the arm bones, the individual's left arm bone to the right arm bone, and you can see this all the way down the right side of the body, the bones were withered. The individual was totally incapacitated on the right side of his body, legs and arms. And so from the development of the bones, we know that this injury to this individual took place around the age of 8 years of old. The individual lived to about 50 or 55 years old. And so again, an instance where we get this a sense of social living and the potential for care deep in our ancient history. that arise from studies of the fossil record of our origins. So that's sharing and caring, just a few examples of that. Brain babies and parenting, of interest to many of us in the room. And one place to start here is, you know, we all think of brains as being, wow, fantastic. It's the pinnacle of our humanity, our complexity of our brains and what they can do. And indeed, they're fantastic. But one of the hallmarks of evolution is that the benefits of adaptations are also offset by costs or disadvantages. And you think, well, what could be so advantageous about it? Well, a big brain, certainly in terms of its benefits, can store decades of information, input and output in split seconds, responsible for the whole variety of ways by which we can feel and express memory and emotions and abstraction, complex ideas, and so on. But the brain as an organ is not a very good deal. It's about 2% of our body weight and takes up about 20 to 25% of our energy at rest. I hope it's taking a little bit more right now. Anyway, it gobbles up energy. It's the energetically most expensive organ in the human body and perhaps of any organ that has emerged in the living world. Also, newborns are born with big heads, and a number of you know the complications and of that, in a direct way. By virtue of having large brains, so much energy in a newborn is put to growing that large brain. I said, what, 20 to 25% in us? Well, in a baby, it's about 65%. Of energy is just going into growing that brain. No wonder they just sort of, no, they don't just sit there, believe me. Yes, that's true. That's right. Got to remember this, yeah. In any case, it's amazing. And therefore, our bodies, the bodies as we grow up, are delayed because so much energy is going to growing a large brain that the development of our bodies and our skills and agility and things like that is delayed. And so it takes a lot to help an infant to grow to maturity. And it requires, you know, parenting and care. And babies, let's start with babies. We all began as babies, right? So let's start as babies. Oh, yeah, some of you, ah, oh, isn't that wonderful? Yeah. But we all start as babies, and babies are fat. There's just no getting around it. And babies have not the kind of fat that a number of us are putting on, which is a white fat, but rather have more of what's called brown fat in terms of its color. It has, the fat cells have more mitochondria, which are those in the cell, the power stations of the cell. And so it's storing a lot, the baby and their fat cells are storing a lot of energy that is fueling the brain, and during tough times, even it's a storehouse of energy for the baby in order to survive. And so, by virtue of growing up so slowly, because of all the energy being put into the growth of the brain, we do, all of us, require care of some sort. Parents, grandparents, sometimes siblings. Even sometimes people that the parents didn't even know, don't even know, help us grow up, and we all require that. And so the question is, let's first take a look at this growing up human. And I wanted to do this compared with other primates. So that top bar is chimpanzees, the life history of chimpanzees from gestation and birth. Through longevity at the end of that bar. And the bottom bar are the stages of the life history of people on average. Humans have these prolonged periods of infancy and to some degree, but especially childhood, where dependency is prolonged much more than any other long-lived primate. And we have, for better or for worse, a unique adolescent phase, where often the growth of the body sort of retains or recovers and catches up with the growth of the rest of the brain and so on. At least we hope. For those of you in the front, you may realize that there's something wrong about this old age beginning at 50. But nonetheless, it does underline something, and that in most mammals, almost all mammals, that longevity pretty much only goes to right after reproductive age. It ends right then. In humans, it's extended. And that is a very interesting part and unique part of our existence as human beings and our life history. We have grandparents. It's very interesting that a number of months ago, there was an article published, a scientific article, that explored a genetic variation that is unique to humans. It's called CD33, the CD33 gene. You know, they put these numbers on them, and believe me, it's longer than that, but I'm giving you the abbreviated version. But CD33, it's on chromosome number 19 in our cells. And this particular genetic variant happens to hinder and obstruct mental decline in older age, after reproductive age is finished. The scientists involved in studying this compared against 79, I think maybe 80 different species of other primates, and found that, nope, all the other primates have another variation of that gene that doesn't prevent the mental decline. And so most of those species die right around the end of reproductive age. And then they looked at the Neanderthal genome. Neanderthals don't have that gene either. It's uniquely human to us, to our species, Homo sapiens. And it's really, really interesting. And so what that means is that since the divergence of our species, our lineage from Neanderthals, that there has been the favoring of a genetic variation that hinders mental decline post-reproduction, which means we have the wonder of grandparents, grandmothers, grandfathers, as caretakers and as sources of knowledge and passing on of culture. So I think that's a spectacular study. How it was found out is that the medical community, they were interested in the risk factors for Alzheimer's. And it's when that gene doesn't go well, that's one of the risk factors. So that's how that was found. And so growing up human, our brain takes a long time to grow. It's energetically expensive. It takes a long time to grow up. And we have these unique childhood and adolescent phases, and grandparents too. So can we know anything about when this living life in the slow lane got started, growing up slowly over a more prolonged period of time? And it turns out that it's amazing that biologists have actually found out how to figure this out. I'm going to mention dentists again. Dentists are actually were the first to figure it out by looking microscopically at teeth. And our teeth begin to grow not only at a young age, but also in the womb, okay? And so it turns out, and this is a microscopic picture of tooth enamel, and that there are individual growth lines, and those growth lines are laid down, a layer of enamel is laid down one day at a time. And so what that means is that we have this timekeeper of tooth growth inside of our teeth, one growth line each day. And not only that, but the day of birth can actually be seen in teeth that are growing when they're in the womb. Birth is probably the most stressful thing any animal can undergo. And the growth of the enamel actually is halted for a short time, and it forms a very concentrated birth line that can be seen in microscopic photos like this one here. Sorry, this doesn't work on the screen. So you can see where it's labeled birth line. And so there's an ability to count for a tooth, its growth, how long it took to grow and to erupt by counting from the day of birth one day at a time and just adding it all up to the time when the tooth burst through and reached the eruption, stage of eruption. And so, and teeth are actually a very good indicator of overall growth of the body. And so, and one of the things that's really cool about this is that this is in a fossil that's 20 million years old. You can see it. All mammals have it. You can see this birth line. This is in a fossil ape known as proconsul, or it's been renamed Ikembo. That's 20 million years old, that comes from East Africa. And so we all have a kind of a birth certificate inside of our teeth, the day we were born. And so this is one of the most complicated chart I'll show you, but growing up fast to slow, and you can see, I don't know if you can see this in the back, but gorilla, chimpanzee, orangutan, and Homo sapiens, our first molar. This is the age when the first molar erupts. And we know that our first molar, we often call it the six-year-old molar, and it erupts around the age of 6 years. That's how long it takes to grow up, and is an indicator of the pacing of the growth of the body overall. And you can see that our other close living genetic relatives, including chimpanzees, are faster. They grow up faster. The age of their first molar erupts more quickly. And so what can we tell then when we look at fossil humans? And there are a variety of different names of species. You can go out and you can see some of the names of those different species in the skulls that are with them. And the ages on the left side, MA refers to millions of years ago. And so 3.2 million years ago, Lucy's species, you may have heard of the famous fossil skeleton from Ethiopia known as Lucy. Her species had an age of first molar eruption that's about three years of age, faster than even that of modern day living great apes. And you can see that it stays fast. I mean, that the timing of eruption, it's not until Homo erectus from fossils that come from about 1 million years old that you get to the pacing of eruption, body growth, the tempo of body growth that you see in modern day great apes, even though they had bodies that looked very similar to us. And it's not until the last 1 million years that you get that incredible slowing down of growth. Last 1 million years. And we see in Neanderthals and in our own species that it's about 6 years, or in Neanderthals even a little bit slower growing up. And so that's really pretty interesting. Well, what else was going on over the last 1 million years? If you go back to an earlier slide and something I noted, the fastest pace of brain evolution, brain expansion, relative to the size of the body was in the last 1 million years. It makes sense that with the expansion of the brain, the growing up took longer to occur. What else was going on? Well, we also see about 800,000 years ago, clear evidence, the first really, really clear evidence of fire hearths, of campsites that have fire hearths in them, from a site in Israel. We have burned seeds, evidence of cooking. And what would cooking do? It helps to release nutrients to help fuel the evolutionary expansion of the brain and the growth for individuals, the growth in individuals of that brain to a larger size. So the control of fire and cooking is also part of this complex. What else do we see? Well, by about 400,000 years ago, we have very clear evidence of more really, really well-built structures of shelters, of huts like this. This particular reconstruction from a site in southern France, Terra Amata, right along the Mediterranean coast, and evidence of post holes and piles of stone that held posts in place to build a shelter, something like that, evidence of fire inside of it. And so there is this intensified sense of home, of protection, safety, and a place to come back to where food was shared. during this this time period. And so this combination of expanded brain, of shelters, of the control of fire and cooking, and slowing down the pace of growth all make sense as real milestones in becoming human, in the emergence of qualities that lie near the center of our understanding of our own humanity. Okay, let's go to the third research story here, innovations, social networking, and symbolic life. And this takes us back to my favorite place in the world. And that's to southern Kenya. And I'm going to tell you about some research that hasn't been published yet. And I've been saying that every place that we've gone around the country. It takes a long time. There are about 40 people, scientists, involved in putting the evidence together that I'm about to show you. But I thought I'd lift the veil a little bit. We hope to be sending in these publications to a well-known journal in about a month and a half. I know my colleagues will not hold me to that, who are here from the Smithsonian. But nonetheless, we're very eager to show this, and I'll show you why. And in excavations such as here, this particular one, and about a dozen excavations that have been carried out by our research team at the site Alorgasaili, we found some really neat things. And Alorgasaili, the site, goes back to about 1.2 million years ago, 1,200,000 years ago. And from 1.2 million years ago to 500,000 years ago, you have the same technology, layer after layer after layer, stone hand axe technology. 700,000 years of the same technology. Can you imagine? I can't keep up with which version of Windows I should be using, you know? And things were just, you know, it was great. It was an adaptable toolkit to be able to, you know, get through times that of changing environment. And it served quite well for the species Homo erectus and probably the species Homo heidelbergensis that came afterwards. And so that's what we see at Alorgasaili up to 500,000 years ago. In our digs, our more recent digs, that are starting around 320,000 years ago, hand axes are gone. That kind of technology no longer exists in the southern Kenya Rift Valley. We can't find it anywhere. And instead, it was replaced by this smaller, more, you might say, mobile technology, stone tools that were not big hand axes like this, that could only be carried a few kilometers or maybe a mile or two from the source of rocks, the sources where the rock was obtained, but could be carried long distances. In fact, quite a bit of the rock is this black rock that you see right to the right of the arrow. That's obsidian rock, really, really beautiful, precious rock. It's not found in the southern Kenya Rift Valley, at least not very close by. And some of the sources of the rock, again chemically, come from about 60 miles away. Okay, not just from 2 miles away, which is what you get at the hand axe levels, but up to 60 miles away, coming in big blocks and not chipped down to nothing. And that's what archaeologists look for, the beginning of exchange, of trade. And so we're really excited about that. Not only that, but the kind of innovations in stone tool making were such that, what I'm going to show you is right at the bottom, and it's the same two artifacts that are shown up in the middle there to the right of the arrow. It's kind of like playing chess with stone tools, where you're thinking many steps ahead. That is, if you're a better player than I am. Many steps ahead in preparing what is going to come down the road. And the core was prepared all the way around such that with one blow, one single blow of the hammer stone, you get these triangular points over and over and over again. And these are small triangular points, and they're the first things that were hafted on to something else and flew through the air. And the world has never been the same since. And so lots of evidence of these innovations of projectile points. And you can see actually damage on the tips of them where they penetrated their objects, their targets. Not only that, but in addition to this smaller, more innovative toolkit, exchange from far away, the use of these blades and projectile points, we have the oldest evidence in Africa of the use of coloring material, of pigments. The collection of red and orange and yellow and black lumps of pigment at these archaeological sites. We don't know what the color, what they were using the color on, but that is really pretty cool. And archaeologists often see the use of color as being the beginning of our capacity for symbolic behavior. And so let's just take stock of this for a moment. This is a timeline at the bottom, and on the left-hand side, it goes back to 280,000 years ago. And on the right side, it goes up to 40,000 years ago. So time is at the bottom there. And I've shown as a marker the oldest known Homo sapiens fossils at around nearly 200,000 years ago. And so innovations near the origin of Homo sapiens. And my colleague Sally McBrearty and Allison Brooks, who actually helped us with these excavations at Allurgus Siley, put together, this is based on something they put together, of a whole bunch of things that were taking place in this time period. It's not the same old layer after layer, but the series of accumulated innovations that we can see in the archaeological record. And this accumulation of innovations, as we mentioned earlier during our early discussion, is one of the characteristics of our humanity. And so what do these things sort of represent? Is that, well, increasing innovation. We have evidence of these social networks, of trade, of being able to know of a group some distance away and to have some interchange with them, exchange with them. Complex symbolic activity that must have required language in the modern human sense. Yes, there must have been some pretty sophisticated means of communicating before this, but in terms of the ability to pass on and to imagine things that you cannot see that is unique to human language, that must have been a part of this parcel of activity, this complex of activity, and then complex thinking and planning itself. And so what does this represent? It's a greater capacity to adjust to changing environments. And we know this time in Africa, in East Africa, was a time of rollicking environmental change, and also the capacity to alter, respond to those changes by altering the surroundings. And the thing that we're going to be reporting in our publications is the extension of some of these quintessential human experiences and activities, behaviors, back at least 40,000 years, if not older than that, in the archaeological record. Let's take for a moment then this oldest known coloring material. This is one of the archaeological sites where we found dozens of these pieces of pigment. They're not accumulated anywhere else off of the site, archaeological site. They had to have formed in a kind of environment that is not represented in the geology of this particular site. So we know that they were transported in by the people who made the stone tools at the site. Again, we don't know what they were coloring. But again, coloring material is often seen as the root of our ability to symbolize and how important that is to us. And if you just think of color, the way we use color in flags and uniforms and so on to indicate our identity, our belonging to groups, or to signal something, this is a very important part of our evidence of our symbolic capabilities. In the upper left there is what I call the world's oldest crayon. It comes from a site that's about 250,000 years old, a site in Zambia. And a place called Twin Rivers, and there's dozens of these faceted pieces of pigment. It has facets on it, just like a Crayola crayon would develop as you're using it. It wouldn't really fit very well into a box of 64, but nonetheless, there it is. We have one of the oldest pieces of representational art in the world in the upper center from a site in Namibia. called Apollo 11 Cave, where there is a kind of a half-human, half-animal kind of form that is placed onto a piece of an ochre slab. And then we have on the right side there of that lion man statue in a site in Germany that's back to about 42 to 45,000 years ago. You know, it's time period of Homo sapiens, when Homo sapiens was moving into Europe, and one of the world's oldest, if not the world's oldest, musical instrument from the same cave in a site in Germany. It has a five-note scale, a pentatonic scale, not the seven-note scale on which our music that we sing is based on. And most music around the world, ethnographic music, is based on a five-note scale. It's made out of, there are versions of it made out of swan bones that are naturally hollow, but also pieces of mammoth ivory that were stuck together and then had the holes. And replicas of these have been made, and they do make a very nice sound. Burial, of course, use of color in burials. This is a much more recent one. It's about 24,000 years old from a site in Siberia, where two children were laid out head to head, and had been dressed apparently in hides that did not preserve, but covered ornately with amazing shells. There are 10,000 shells that are right around the bodies, and ochre that was sprinkled that you could still see on the bones of the skeleton. And then the one in the middle, one of my favorite examples, of course, cave art, just amazing. Cave art where color was used. This happens to be a cave in France called Chauvet Cave, and some of you may have heard of Chauvet Cave. It's about 32,000 years old, the cave paintings on this. And the story that I particularly like is that when my colleague Jean Clot and his team were in there, and they discovered it deep, deep, deep inside this dark cave, and they went in, they discovered it with flashlights, and they were just amazed, and they were amazed that maybe some of you can see that there's almost like this double imprinting or striking of like the woolly rhinoceros in that center drawing up in the upper left part of it. Or the series of cave lions, where one cave lion is imposed upon another, but slightly offset. They had no idea what this was all about, but the local mayor wanted to get involved in it. Is the local mayor here? No, okay. Anyway, whose comments, by the way, I deeply appreciated. It's fantastic. And his appreciation of the library is terrific. In any case, the local mayor wanted to see this with his own eyes. And so the archaeologist said, let's treat him to a real Stone Age experience. And they lit flickering torches, and they went in there, and they went deep inside the cave, and in the flickering light, they move. It's the first animation that the lion moves across the surface of the stone and the woolly rhinoceros moves back and forth. It gives me chills every time I tell this story. And they were us 32,000 years ago. I keep your eye out in the press. I just got about 2 hours ago, 3 hours ago, before coming here, a reporter sending me a report about cave art. May not be as spectacular as that, but going in France, going back to 38,000 years, which would be the oldest in that part of Western Europe, in any case. And so I think that the innovations and technology that I've shown you, the use of color, the variety of things that come from this kind of study, speak to the early roots of our complex thinking and reasoning abilities. They speak to our ability for imagination and for even thinking and talking about things that we can't see in our immediate surroundings, the ability for abstraction. And to me, these sorts of discoveries also, I think, relate to our own desire to understand what it means to be a human being. And so in the discoveries that we've looked at here tonight so far, that you can explore in the exhibit, This is, to me, one of the more astonishing things that we can examine. It's a tree, and there's lots of debate about who is related to whom when new fossils are discovered. Lots of debate about that, and sometimes, you know, we scientists get caught up in that kind of thing. There have been many branches, many twigs that have been added to our evolutionary tree over the last two decades of discovery in particular. But one of the things that is really clear here is that we are all, every single human being on the face of the earth, you and me and everyone else, is part of an immense genealogy. We're part of a tree of kinship. And these variety of species, and again, you can explore which ones or who is who in the exhibit out there, all had this ability to stand upright on two legs, small canine teeth, but also had some combination of the other features that distinguish our species, Homo sapiens, from others. Okay. They had some unique combination of what it means to be a human being today from at least a biological standpoint. Another thing that you might see, though, is that we're the last ones left. We're the last biped standing, as I call it. And what that means is that all of these other ways of life represented by these evolutionary ancestors and cousins of ours are no longer around on the face of the earth. And through the study of this, we can bring them to light and hopefully understand them in some way. But certainly one thing that does is that it gives us a lot to ponder. And it certainly underlines and highlights the fragility of life, even in our own immense journey through time. And then another thing that it represents to me is the unity of humankind. That the emergence of human qualities goes back and has, that we all share, goes back 6 million years. It's a 6 million year inheritance that we all share. And I think that makes pale in comparison the time period of centuries, sometimes only decades, sometimes only years, over which our differences have arisen. And so I hope I've interested you in some of the main themes and ideas that you can explore in the exhibit Exploring Human Origins. And in conclusion, I'd just like to emphasize one other key message of the exhibit. And it relates to, again, our initial discussion, where you all contributed, or many of you contributed, ideas about what it means to be human. And the point is that research has made discoveries about the origin of many of the features that distinguish our species, Homo sapiens, from other forms of life. And yet the way that people, all of us, understand the word human and the ways that we think about ourselves are often so far broader than what research on human evolution can study. And so the exhibit, Exploring Human Origins, and the terrific set of programs you have here upcoming in the library, I hope it's an invitation, but I hope also a real opportunity for you to ponder how our lives, that is the things that make a difference to us, and research findings in human evolution can meet and become acquainted with one another. Thanks very much. I'm happy to take questions. I don't know how long some of you want to hang around. I'm here the rest of the night. I'm an all-nighter kind of guy. So. No, I'm kidding. Yeah. Yes, please, sir.
You talked about color being sort of archaeologically the origin of symbolic.
So it's symbolic behavior, right?
Yeah. But what are the thoughts around the things that aren't permanent, things like sound and voice and speaking? What evidence is there? What do you know about that?
Yeah, almost that's a really great question, because almost certainly there are intangible things or things that would simply not preserve that could also have been part and parcel of symbolic behavior before, you know, we have color. One of the things that I think is important in these sorts of discoveries is that when did symbolic behavior become so important that people also made objects that were symbolic? And that's actually what we're seeing as an archaeologically discoverable moment or period when we know symbolism became so important that it also found its way into material culture. Yeah, please, sir.
Well, the oldest DNA that has been gotten from early human bones is 400,000 years ago. There's a cave site in Spain where first mitochondrial but now nuclear DNA has been recovered, and it nails 400,000 years ago, as by that stage Neanderthals had evolved in Europe. We share a common ancestor probably with, well, we know we do, with share a common ancestor with Neanderthals. And the African versions of that species, that common ancestor, evolved into Homo sapiens, and the European branch evolved into Neanderthals. Part of the thing is that you're absolutely right, it breaks down. DNA is a kind of molecule that will break down. We don't have DNA yet from very far back in time, from warmer environments. It's cold environments where there is protection, often in cave sites, where we have it. And so, I mean, there has been also a lot of controversy. I understand maybe some new evidence that has either just come out or about to come out about finding some products of DNA, some DNA nucleotides perhaps that have been recovered from very, very ancient bones. There's been a lot of effort on dinosaurs from up to 65 million to 100 million years old, where this effort is taking place, because everyone's excited about dinosaurs. Way before us, but nonetheless. And that has not been shown so far. But in the fossil, it's one of these things that, 10 years ago, we would not have known that there was going to be a Neanderthal genome project. And so the ability to recover this stuff is really fascinating, and I think that we'll see a lot of progress in that field of research. Yes, please.
You had mentioned, was it CD33?
CD33 gene.
The mutation. Is there an analog in whales? Because I thought whales is the only other mammal where there's an existence past menopause.
Yeah. I do not know the answer to that question. I'm sure there is an analog, because I think all mammals have some kind of an analog there, and the product of that gene is basically protects the neurons, and the whales must do it somehow by being able to stay around for after post-reproductive years. So I imagine there may be an analog there. That's a really interesting question that was not addressed in that paper. Yeah. Yes?
You speak of the evolution of walking. We know when humans began to run.
There's been some research on that. A good colleague of ours used to teach at George Washington University, where Paul got his PhD. Daniel Lieberman is now at Harvard University, and he has done quite a bit of research on running, putting a variety of organisms on treadmills, including students. And what he's found are some of the anatomical correlates of the way in which, if you feel in the back here, we have a tendon that connects from our vertebrae up to that little knob on the back of our skulls. And that helps to stabilize the skull while running. And where that is weakly developed, those tend to be animals that don't run. Where it's strong, well developed, it's animals that do run, particularly if they have a more upright kind of body. Dan and several of his colleagues think that that goes back to about 2 million years ago. That makes sense, because we see the elongation
of the legs as and a change in the body proportions, certainly occurring by 2 to 1.5 million years ago, so it makes sense that that capability was there. But what they were using that running capability for, we don't know. Dan says it was hunting. Others would disagree and don't think that there's really strong evidence of the kind of hunting that modern day peoples who run after a kill, after a hunt, after they've shot, say, an animal with a poison arrow will do. So exactly what that overall behavior was, we don't know, but running probably goes back to that age.
And also, though, the ability to sweat, to perspire, to run, to dissipate heat.
Yeah.
Does that also explain why we're naked?
Yeah. We're not exactly naked. We have about the same density of hair as other great apes, but it's just very short. And so the exposure of the skin is due to more to the shortness of the hair. And of course, human populations all across the globe vary a great deal in how much body hair there is in any case. But probably around that same time. And one of the bits of evidence is not only the evidence indirect of running, but also in the species Homo erectus, which we certainly see in the fossil record by about 1.8 to 1.9 million years ago, almost 2 million, is that we see the expansion of the nasal cavity. And you think, well, how could that relate to sweating? Well, developing the bridge of the nose where the nasal bones come together, you look at the skulls out there, at least the pictures of them, and there's five that you can twirl around and look at, is that in before Homo erectus, you have basically a flat facial profile, just like great apes, where the nose is basically part of the same plane as the face. In Homo erectus, we get the first indication of a bridge of the nose, which means an expansion of the nasal cavity, and the expansion of the nasal cavity is where all that mucous membrane is that deals with what happens with water when you breathe in and when you breathe out. And so when you breathe in air, especially if it's dry, hot air, or especially if it's cold, dry air, which we all experience, okay, your nose starts to drip in that kind of environment. Well, inside there are all these eddies. The air goes through all this mucous membrane and becomes humidified. Breathe into the lungs. Well, what would happen if you breathed it out? You'd lose water really quickly. So it comes back out, eddies around, and all that water drops off into the mucous membrane. And then you breathe out relatively unhumid water, still humidified somewhat. But that is a great water retention mechanism, and Homo erectus had it. And so we think that water and the ability to cool due to sweating was at a premium with Homo erectus. So that's where we were passing. I hope I kind of made the connections. The question was about our diet and the history of meat eating. And the evidence for eating meat really comes with the advent of stone tools. So 2.5 million years ago, we have evidence of cut marks on bones, indicating that morsels of muscle tissue, meat, essentially, from large animals was obtained. So that's about as far back as it goes. We have evidence from the chemistry of teeth of not just only humans, but other fossil organisms as well, and present day ones, about the proportion of plant foods in the diet. And there was almost always plant foods, or really were always plant foods in the diet. I never became completely a meat eating diet by any stretch. But the ability to eat meat is a very interesting thing that a lot of people think about with regard to the geography of human origins. If you're going into new places, you'll find new plants all the time. And new plants, the fruits and the other things, can have different toxins in them, secondary compounds, things that make you feel sick in the stomach or can kill you. And one of the things that could really, if you're moving quickly through a territory, that could help buffer that is that meat is pretty much meat everywhere. Okay, and so it may have the ability to eat meat and to have it as part of a diverse diet may have been very important as part of the expansion of Homo erectus a little bit after 2 million years ago, and certainly ourselves. Brianna Popener, my colleague here, studies this kind of thing with regard to hunting, scavenging in particular, and meat eating. That's how my first paper ever published was on the subject of cut marks on bones. And people ask Brianna, especially all the time, about the paleo diet, and I love her answer, which paleo diet? You know, because one of the things that is part of human adaptability is the ability to shift what you eat. And so the idea that there is one prescribable diet, you're not going to get it from us. Yes, please.
Is it reasonable to imagine that as there have been many people before us, the Homo erectus before us, the Homo sapiens and so forth, is it reasonable to anticipate that several hundred thousand years from now there will be something else like a Homo super duper?
Write down that name, it's a great song. Yes. Next question. Well, yeah. I mean, you know, it's very interesting. Is that, well, what does it take to the evolutionary process where you have gene pools that once were united and they become separate and start to have their own history and can change over time and adjust to new and different challenging settings? Does that sound familiar, like something from the future? Space travel. You know, that would be one thing that one could imagine, whereby different, you know, divergence of gene pools do occur. Now, you know, that you asked me about hundreds of thousands of years in the future, so I'm entitled to a little bit of sci-fi. But that would be the kind of thing. I'm not saying that Star Trek was, you know, prescient about this sort of thing, but nonetheless, those are the sorts of conditions that we know in evolutionary biology produce new species, and one could imagine that. Now, the part of the idea of your question, though, is that will we become somehow superhuman, super duper? And there is no progress in evolution. There's lots of adaptation to local surroundings, which is how different things and diversity occurs in the tree of life, and how all that diversity in the tree of the hominins, ourselves and our ancestors and evolutionary cousins occurred. And so it's very, very hard to use our mind to say, ah, because this is a trend, this will happen hundreds of thousands of years ago from now. Evolution really doesn't work that way. It works on conditions that we don't necessarily know will occur. And so tell your great, 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 great to stay tuned. Yes, please.
You touched a little bit on the traveling, that it started thousands or hundreds of thousands of years. Are we talking that it's trade route based or is it nomadic based?
Yeah, it's with regard to the expansion of Homo erectus and then the later, about 60 or 70, 75,000 years ago, for the expansion of Homo sapiens within Africa, to many parts of Africa, as well as beyond Africa. It's largely a nomadic kind of thing. And so there's lots of questions about, well, what was the driving force there? We don't necessarily see anything like trade routes until much later in history, like with the Silk Road and things like that. So it's an interesting point, but it's a nomadic base. And so people ask me all the time, what could have been driving it? You know, on my rougher moments, I say teenage angst or something, you know, get away from the parents, let's go over to that next hillside, whatever. But it's very interesting that in the time period of Homo sapiens expansion, it was a time of very strong climate fluctuations. There is a beautiful record of environmental change from Lake Malawi in Africa, in southern eastern Africa. And there they show this big changes, sweeping changes between very wet and very dry. And it's thought that perhaps during the better times when populations were expanding, then it would dry off in a corridor back to the homeland and was cut off. And it's kind of like a pump, okay? The populations didn't know that there was an Asia. They didn't know there was a Europe or anything. There were no maps back then. But that would be one of the ways that could have environmentally have helped the process along.
Thank you.
I'll take a couple more. Yes, please.
I may be good at all, but you showed that like first coming out from Africa was like 7 million years ago, right?
About 1.7, 1.8 million years.
Yes. And our civilization is sort of much younger in comparison to that. So, and our direct ancestors are not from the first coming out from Africa. So, is modern science, does modern science have any ideas what happened with previous coming out from Africa? Mm. What happened to those people?
Yeah.
Maybe they are just not the first civilization besides. Like lots of evidences archaeological that there were some very sophisticated sites, like building structures.
Yeah, we don't have anything that it looks anything like buildings or groups of buildings or structures that would be evidence of what archaeologists call a complex society. In other words, a state society with different classes and things like that that are characteristic of civilizations that go back much more than about 7,000 years ago, 8,000 years ago maybe. We have with development of domestication of animals and plants and settling down, you have the kind of situation that is the precursor to the settling down of people and dependence upon one another for building civilizations. So back to the first part of your question, well, what happened to those people who went out? There's a lot of, we have evidence from stone tools. We know that where they were in terms of where their fossils are, their fossil bones were buried or where they were naturally found due to natural burial. But nothing like building anything that would be called a city or a town or anything like a civilization. There is a very, again, it goes back to this whole matter of genomics too, is that we know that the Neanderthals were a different species from us. Now you may say, well, wait a second. I thought that there was evidence of mating of Homo sapiens with Neanderthals. And there's this a group of early humans that we don't know exactly what they look like because all we had were a few teeth and a bone from the small finger that was used to get the DNA out from a cave in Siberia, a Denisovan cave. And it indicates a genome that's different from Neanderthals, different from Homo sapiens. And yet we find fragments, and in some cases, functioning genes that were unique to Neanderthals and unique to the Denisovans in modern human populations. But it looks like that would have occurred with Neanderthals up to about 50,000 years ago with the first populations of Homo sapiens coming out, but then nothing after that. And it may have been the last thing that made those lineages diverge. The formation of species is a process, it's not an event. And so that echo within the genes and within the genomes of non-African people, of Neanderthals, about 2% on average of the non-African genomes, are indicative of that time of interbreeding across species, but that led to the final divergence of those lines. And the Neanderthals died out about 35 to 40,000 years ago. Why they died out, we don't know. That's a tough question. Yeah. One more, please, yes.
I have heard that about 7,000 years ago, the human population had contracted to about a population of 2,000 people in Africa.
Yeah.
And then basically we developed.
Right. Yeah. What happened? Yeah, that's a good question. Genetics labs are in raging debate about this kind of thing. Some of them say that if you look at all modern human genetic diversity, that you can kind of trace it back to a founding population for all of that diversity of about 2,000 breeding individuals. Other labs say no, 10,000. Other labs say as few as 600 individuals. Were we almost endangered species? And so what happened? The labs that are more on the 10,000 are probably, they seem to be winning the debate. But it was 10,000 for a long period of time, as opposed to an immediate event down to 2,000 or 600. And so what was occurring during that time in our own species? between about 130,000 and 70,000 years ago was something that was really keeping the human population quite small. And one of the things, again, that we see, partly this drill core that I mentioned, and very, very beautiful climate record from Lake Malawi, and now we're testing it with the drill core that we've gotten from the early human site in Eastern Africa, shows lots of fluctuations. The survival conditions were constantly changing and was a major, major stressor on those populations. And yet what I've shown you here and the discoveries we hope to be publishing soon is the root of that adaptability that got those populations through. And what can I say? We're now 7.3 billion and counting. Thank you very much. You've been a terrific audience.